Hello and a very warm welcome to a brand new edition of our show From Logo to Impact. I'm in conversation with Jeremy Rowe, Managing Director, AkzoNobel Decorative Paints. He heads the initiatives in Southeast and South Asia, as well as Middle East. Great to have you with us on the show. And Farhan Akhtar, of course, the brand ambassador for AkzoNobel in India. Great to have you too. You know, let me start off by asking, in terms of the Indian market right now, Jeremy, how have you seen it evolve over a period of time? Because obviously there have been changes, the market is growing, but so is the competition. So at this point in time, where is it poised?
Well, I think you described it the right way. It's a growing, exciting market. And if you look especially to the future, you know, of the Indian market over the next 10, 20 years, it's going to be a spectacular growth market. And yeah, we're going to be in there fighting with everybody else to get our share.
So there is the challenge, and over there your marketing initiatives are really going to come to play. So in terms of innovation and being able to engage the customer that much more, where is it exactly moving?
Well, innovation is something anyway that Dulux as a brand has always stood for. So we continue to invest in that, and in the last year or two we've seen a number of new products coming to market, plus a number of new services like our Dulux Visualizer augmented reality app, so
sure,
you can see things before they paint. So there's lots of new things that we want to bring to the market. We've still got many things to go, of course, so the next couple of years we'll see a lot more innovation from the brand as well.
Yes.
And then the second is bringing the brand to life, which is through many ways, but Farhan is obviously one of those important ways in
right,
which we bring the brand to life for people.
Exactly. So then when you associate a face to a brand, which is all very crucial, when especially in a competitive market, what was the thought behind getting Farhan on board? This happened 3 years ago and he's been consistently with the brand. What was the thought then?
Well, it's not just about the face, although he does have a handsome face, doesn't he? But yeah, what it's about is when you're obviously working with someone who as a brand endorser, is that you want them to be like the brand and to represent what the brand is. And I think in Farhan we saw a number of things, certainly his talent and versatility, which is also what we as a brand like to stand for. We like people who have their own personal sense of style, which he obviously does.
Correct.
And will speak to the new young generation of users in the country as well. So for us it was a wonderful combination of bringing those things together.
Right.
With Farhan.
You know, the importance, Farhan, of infusing Bollywood in all the brands as far as their positioning goes, that's become very crucial. Cricket and Bollywood, nothing works as well as these two do in the Indian context. So you of course endorse a lot of products and brands. So when it comes to AkzoNobel, for one, I want to understand the entire process of how your approach, what the thought process is, where the pitch is made to be able to convince you, to be able to put your face and name to it.
I think the first criteria really is, would I use it? I think that's really where it starts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, would I use it? Would I be happy using it? And would I recommend it to people, even if I wasn't the brand ambassador of this, of this brand? So that's really where it starts. And then beyond that, I think, like as Jeremy said, I think you look for certain personality similarities within what the brand stands for, what the brand is trying to do, and what you're trying to do.
Sure.
You know, within your own career and with your own work. And when that fit feels, when that synergy feels good, then it feels like the right thing to do. You know,
right,
to go ahead, because you have to apply yourself. It's not something you say, okay, fine, I'm going to do it, and then I'll just meet you on the day and nothing else matters.
Correct.
You know, it's a process. You're evolving together. You're developing ideas together. So many things go on behind the scenes. You
correct.
Know, it's just that we get to meet this once,
yeah,
once a year maybe,
sure,
you know, and interact, but there's a lot more to it.
And yeah, certainly we want to work with brand ambassadors who bring their own creativity into the process.
Right.
If we're working together, it's a two-way, it's a partnership as well.
Right. So what do you seek from someone like Farhan?
Well, I'd say particularly what we like is someone who has a very personal sense of style and that they can help consumers to understand how to bring out their own personality,
mm-hmm,
particularly into their interior design and exterior design, but also through clothes and fashion and something else, because that inspires people to do the same in their homes.
So this is what I'm finding interesting, because generally now positioning of a brand is much more than just the product positioning, right? It's more about a brand philosophy that gets transmitted, especially through brand ambassadors like Farhan. You see that across the board, Farhan, where there is a larger philosophy, because it's not just about standing with a tin of paint,
yeah,
right?
It can't be. But the thing is, I mean, we can only speak for ourselves. You know, the different people approach work differently from the way I approach it.
Correct.
You know, so, I mean, for me, it is important that there needs to be something that I can connect with, mm-hmm, within what the brand is trying to do, trying to achieve for themselves, how I could play a role in making that a possibility, because then it's a collective success. It's not just, again, it can't be about just stepping in when you ask for that one day to give your time.
Sure.
You know, say some words that are written on a piece of paper.
Right.
You know, and leave, because I mean, there really is no growth in that. There's no learning in that. There's no celebration in that.
Right.
Of what you're doing.
Right.
So those experiences are important, and you're absolutely right. You're not only selling up. You're selling a you're selling a sensation to someone.
Right.
You know, you're selling them a dream and an idea of how you can use this to maybe improve something about your life, improve something about yourself.
Correct.
You know, maybe make you, I don't know, just kind of live in a slightly more motivational, inspirational environment.
Yes.
You know, so these things are important.
Right. So are you transmitting a lot of these messages through your social media presence as well? Is that something that happens, and is that something that you seek as well? Farhan, are you already doing it?
You know, I do it in different ways. You know, it doesn't necessarily need to have to be only about speaking about a brand. You know, it's various things. I mean, whether it's my film work, my music work, my work with MARD, the initiative that I have.
Yes.
I feel it's important for people who have been fortunate like myself and given a certain kind of position in society where people, I mean, they don't really have to listen to you all the time, but they do hear you,
right.
You know, when you say something. So if you can use that to try and make some changes, which are changes for better, you know, to inspire people to maybe improve on themselves, improve what's around them.
Right.
Absolutely, why not? You know, and aesthetic, being a creative person and who makes films and it deals with art, you know, aesthetic is a really important thing.
Yes.
You know, so that's another idea that you always do talk about.
Do you see that getting traction? Do you see that making a difference really to the audience that you're trying to address? Has that happened, and
absolutely.
How much more are you pushing it?
No, absolutely. But I think it's best when it happens organically, a bit like Farhan was saying.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the social media space is a space where you need the brand to find its place.
Right.
If you force it too much, I don't think it works very well.
Right.
Because social media, people are also looking for an authentic voice, not
mm-hmm.
not an inauthentic one. So I think, for example, as Farhan says, when he now speaks on any matter to do with aesthetics or style, he will be associated with the brand, and that will happen in a very natural, organic way.
Sure. But there is a thought process within the brand as well as to where you want to position it, yeah?
Well, Julius absolutely has been known as a very high quality, as a premium brand, as an excellent brand, and that we're not going to lose. Obviously, that's a very important and precious thing for any brand to have, and Dulux has that.
Okay.
At the same time, yes, we are making the brand more accessible through different price points and different availabilities.
Right. You work in a lot of geographies, and I'm going to take it up with your colleague a little later into this episode as well. But how distinctive is the Indian market right now? Because obviously it brings a lot more color in terms of your marketing strategy for the kind of many Indias that exist in one. So does that in itself pose a challenge?
Yes, I mean, all markets are different, and indeed it's a trap to think of one India as well as it is a trap to think about one China and something else, because even within a market there's a great deal of diversity
right.
when it comes to the use of color and product and design, because it's all a combination of cultural heritage, of what people have done in the past versus new trends and fashions coming in. They all clash together
sure.
In terms of what people want. So what's really important is just we are available. We're available in colors. We're available in products. We're accessible through the media to people so that they, when they come to take those decorating decisions, we're there for them. So it's the brand adapts itself quite well to different circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
In a way, we're lucky. We're probably the only global paint brand. So we have to be also universal in many ways about what people want from color and what they want from paint.
Sure.
But also specific in markets like India to make sure we meet people's needs. And I think we get that balance about right.
Right. Farhan, I started asking you about Bollywood and how placements and brand promotions really actually work through films in our context. If I turn back time in Yaade, for example, it kind of started off with the lead actors having bottles of Coke at that point in time. You remember this. And then in Bagma, for example, we saw a lot more brands getting associated. It kind of kick-started the entire process of getting all these brand placements going in films, and people saw the importance of doing that. Of course, a lot has changed since then, but how did you view it then? Because obviously you've been involved for a long time, and from the time that you started with Dichata Hai, with XL, with Ritesh Sidwani, at that point in time, were there thoughts that, you know, this is another revenue stream and you're making a film?
All honesty, I mean, that's something that Ritesh focused a lot more on.
Did he?
You know, I also come from a world of advertising. I was in advertising for 3 years before I got into film.
Exactly.
You know, so there's always, within those spaces when we used to have meetings or speak to agencies, there was always that potential because product placement, brand association was always big in the West. You know, you saw that in many films, like the Bond films and many other films.
Correct.
But it never really started working here till much later.
Yeah.
You know, so there would always be people speaking about it that we could do something with the film. And then when I became a filmmaker, I mean, for me, there was always this idea that we could use it, but never to the point where it feels like a hard sell. Because nobody wants to come into a film and be sold a product, they want to be sold a story, you know?
Yeah.
So the thing is that it has to be done very smartly. And I think initially there was a certain wave of excitement that, oh, people are getting involved and there's revenues coming in.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of the product placement happened very shoddily. in my opinion.
Yeah, there was not too much smartness.
But now I think it's become very smart. I think now people are doing it a lot smarter. And there are many films now that are associated at times with 12 products and 14 products, and you see them in the film.
Yeah.
You know, and they maybe leave little subliminal messages in your mind for having just recognized that brand or having recognized something, and you go back home and maybe remember it at some point when you go to have a similar experience within that category. But it's become smart now. So I think it's as long as it doesn't upset the viewer, you know, that they feel like, okay, I came in here to watch a film and now they've started selling me something.
Correct.
You know, I think that balance is truly important in storytelling.
And you think we're striking it right now?
No, absolutely.
Yeah? Absolutely. So aesthetically, it doesn't kind of interfere with the creative process of filmmaking?
No, it doesn't, because it happens much later. You know, I mean, it's never factored in unless there's something very specific in the film.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which has happened in certain movies where a certain product is truly crucial to the script.
Right.
You know, like, so say, for example, if a film is about a cycle, you know, I mean, then that cycle is going to be really, really marketed as well within the film.
Correct.
You know, because people will speak about it. They'll speak about the brand. You'll never say Meri cycle. You know, you'll always say something more than that.
Yes.
So, but if it's not that specific,
right,
you know, then beyond that, you have to be very, very smart of how you use it, because it also damages the brand. You know, people kind of get repulsed by what's happening with the brand in the film.
Correct.
You know, they feel that they're trying to take advantage of the fact that we actually like the filmmaker, or we like the actor, or we like, you know. So it has to be done very smartly, because it benefits nobody.
Yeah, absolutely. So since there is this smartness that's coming into the entire branding process within a film, you're seeing this co-branding exercise as well. So there is the entire system where there is the upfront kind of deal that is struck, where a film is launching and you're going to pay them to kind of have that kind of positioning within that film. Or perhaps you're going to have a co-promotion.
Yeah.
That system is coming into play as well. So does that work better? And since you're making films, tell us exactly how the process actually comes to play.
Well, I mean, in all honesty, I mean, as long as, again, there needs to be a synergy between the brand and what the film is about,
mm-hmm,
even for a post complete film co-promotion deal, you know, to happen. I mean, on any film, like, be it Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, or be it Dawn, or be it Dil Dhadakne Do, I mean, there's many offers that you get of a product that wants to associate because they feel, okay, the film looks like it's going to be interesting and people are going to want to know about it.
Correct.
So let's get involved. But the brand has nothing to do with what the film is about. You know, so you have to say no. I mean, we say no.
Right. So in terms of marketing strategy, are there any radical shifts that you're planning to make now in the near future?
So we've seen some big changes in the digital space. I think we'll see more as well when we look forward in the next 5-10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see brands like ours finding new ways to communicate collectively across a number of media with a number of different vehicles to be able to bring the brand message across. That's probably going to be the biggest change.
Excellent. Good luck going ahead.
Thank you.
It's great to have you with us.
Thank you,
Farhan, Jeremy. Cheers. We'll take a quick break right now, but on the flip side, we're continuing our discussion with where Dulux is positioning itself in India. We'll be chatting with Shraddha Kapoor as well in just a moment. Do stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to this edition of our show From Logo to Impact. In the earlier part, we were looking at Dulux Paints' strategy as far as the Indian market is concerned. We're getting a deeper insight right now. Joining us is Rajiv Rajgopal, Director, Decorative Paints at AkzoNobel India. Great to have you with us. And of course, the new brand ambassador for Dulux. We spoke about Farhan Akhtar just a while ago, Shraddha. 3 years over there, and
right,
now you're the new addition.
I know, I'm so excited.
So what was the pitch that was made to you? Considering that they already had a face to the brand, how difficult was it to convince you to come on board as the other face?
No,
the
you know, the thing is that it is, if you believe in a brand and you would paint your home walls using Dulux, then you will obviously want to endorse it as well.
Rajiv, tell me, what was the thought process in getting another brand ambassador? You already had Farhan Akhtar.
So Farhan has done a impeccable job for us. I think he's really made the brand stand out from the clutter. Farhan came on the brand in 2012, and it's 3 years.
Yes.
Farhan's not just doing work for us in India. He will shortly start doing work for us outside. We then said, look, the consumer, when we did a lot of equity researches, said, look, if you really look at Dulux, it did a lot of innovations in the market in 2005. It's almost a decade. And really, when can we see a lot more from you? And we did indeed launch Deluxe Velvet Touch Diamond Glow,
right,
as a variant of our flagship brand, Velvet Touch. And really started doing well. And the moment the brand started doing well, we went back to the consumers and saying, how do you see the brand? And I think the one name that came all across was Shraddha Kapoor, because I think she stands for a lot of modernity. She brings in certain values which are very much linked to the brand. You know, you can see her trying to make a tremendous impact on the next generation through all her films.
Next generation is what I'm hearing a lot of. And Shraddha, that's where you're fitting in for so many of the other brands, right? We're seeing so many of her contemporaries do the same thing, whether it's Alia, whether it's Siddharth Malhotra, all of them. Varun Dhawan, they're part of this entire new brigade. But you know, the creative process of you know, getting involved on the behind the scenes kind of action, social media being that kind of space, all of that messaging needs to go out. How do you go about it?
I've just come on board. You know, I really look forward to a very nice and long association with them. And I would love to give my suggestions to them. And
have you done that in the past with your other endorsements as well? Has that happened?
You know, the thing is that it just automatically happens if you, as I said, believe in the brand.
Sure.
That you want to put a piece of yourself into it. Yeah.
But so I can tell you that amongst, you know, brand ambassadors that I've spoken to, Shraddha is very forward-looking.
Sure.
She definitely would like to understand how the brand is going to sort of look at her, how she can sort of be a part of the brand.
Right.
She's very keen in understanding the process of the creative.
Absolutely.
Right? And adding value to the entire digital space.
Yes. Sorry to butt in, but you know, Jeremy, I was just speaking to him about the positioning of the brand, which seems to be more in the urban context. Now, getting Shraddha on board, perhaps, does that kind of widen the kind of audience that you're reaching out to, and getting that kind of much more focused approach to be able to widen your market within tier 2, tier 3 cities, and being able to reach out to them and getting that kind of engagement going? Because perception-wise, Dulux seems to be in the premium segment, and I'm not quite sure how well you're doing within the smaller towns and cities.
So you're absolutely right. Dulux has got a higher share in the premium segment, but I think that's something that we are very cognizant of trying to be available across the portfolio and across all markets.
Right.
And that's something that we've done over the last couple of years.
How do you change that? And getting Shraddha on board, how does that kind of...
Well, I will be revealing strategy to you, and I think you've got to...
That's what
know,
I'm
sort
after.
Of, you've got to just
That's
watch it patiently. but I can just tell you this, and I'll give you an example. I think today, the digital is the greatest leveler. Irrespective of which town you come from, whether you're a class 1 town, class 2 town. I mean, in a country where 900 million people are already on the mobile, almost 300 people or million on the internet, right?
Yes.
And you get about more than 100, 150 million people on, you know, social media like Facebook, and, you know, maybe 100 odd on Twitter now, right? I think the country is hugely progressing.
Right.
So the challenge, and really the question we ask ourselves as marketeers, is how can we leverage those social media, be an integral part of the social media?
That's where the action is. But Shraddha, your presence over there really would help a brand that you're endorsing, right? Your presence
but
in the social
media space. But she's just mentioned, you know, she just sort of walked in.
Yeah, no, but of course, I mean, that's going to grow, but you're already doing it for the other brands that you endorse.
Right.
So,
I think it all begins again with, you know, if I'm going to endorse something that I believe in, it takes care of like half of, you know, everything just becomes organic then. When you talk about the brand, when you integrate it into your life, and then you share it with the world. For example, if I will be getting, when I do get my house done, I will be posting a picture of my wall, or, you know, it's so personal to you that people automatically relate to that, and they and when they follow your films and you as a celebrity or as an actor so closely, they would also be inspired, and they would also want to imbibe your beliefs, which
sure.
would also in turn be the brands that you endorse.
Right. When you're talking about you know, films that you started off with, and Aashiqui being one, a lot of your contemporaries have taken this multiple star approach route to be able to launch themselves, while you are the one who kind of went out there in that kind of solo kind of scenario to be able to make your presence felt. You are a bit of a risk taker. How many risks do you take when you're endorsing a brand?
You know, actually, my first film was an ensemble cast. Unfortunately, a lot of people didn't watch it. That is a separate matter. It can scare you to take some decisions, but if your gut tells you that it's right, you have to do it.
Correct.
You have one life to live. Why would you want to
right.
not fulfill your dreams and take some risks? You know,
right.
would you rather, when you're like 90 years old, be like, oh, I wish I took that risk, you know?
Sure.
So it's better to do things that frighten you a little bit, but will give you that joy. Than not do it at all and play it safe. How much can you play it safe?
Exactly. And that's what brands are doing as well, right?
Absolutely.
Pushing the kind of possibilities, kind of barriers as well. At this point in time, when you're looking at growing a brand, how much clutter-breaking work can actually happen when you're trying to shake up the market, because this is very competitive? How do you do it?
Well, I think as long as you've got a consumer benefit, which is where the consumer can really say, yep, there is a functionality in it, and there is an emotional payoff that I can get from it, I personally think that brands can be stretched. Right. And you're right. You know, the point you were alluding to today, I think the world has moved hugely on social media. And I just wanted to remind Shraddha that, you know, I follow her on Twitter. And I think the way she's building her brand is, I think, quite impeccable.
Right.
Yeah, and I personally think that's the sort of challenges the brand has. Because the brand has to, you know, constantly engage, re-engage with its consumers and customers, make sure it's delivering greater value. I personally think that it's going to be a great journey ahead.
Exactly. So medium and messenger, both very, very important, as we can see. And the messenger being you in this case, Shraddha. You're taking the brand message across. Great to have you with us and get your perspective on this as well. Thanks indeed. We will, of course, take a little break. But on the other side, this is what's coming up on the show.